evening, folks. If you were here last night, thank you for coming again. If you're here for the first time tonight, thank you for coming at all. And we hope this won't be your last visit either, because this is lecture number 2 in the series of 8, which the kind folks in Aberdeen have asked me to come here and deliver. A great privilege to do that. It's a subject I'm very interested in, and I'm trying to make you interested in it as well. So tonight's lecture will once again, I hope, be interesting, informative, maybe entertaining, although that's stretching a point, but I hope it will be challenging. Before I begin, just a couple of things to mention. Number one, I must point out the fire escapes from this building, one there and one in the door through which I assume you came when you entered the building. Hope we don't need them, but there they are. Second point is, I did mention yesterday that during my lecture there are quite a few things you want to ask about. Not always easy to do that face to face, so to help you in that direction, there is a pad and paper by the doorway on my left, and a box to pop the papers in once you've written on them what you think you'd like me to answer. I can't pretend to answer all the questions. I don't know all the answers, but maybe I can point you in the right direction. And any questions that are submitted, I will promise to deal with either tomorrow or on Thursday of this week when this first set of lectures end. As usual, as you will have noticed, there will be tea and coffee at the end, and opportunity then for some chat. But let's get started. Last evening, I was really posing a big question. Created or evolved? What does science say? And I was trying to find out to you that science really gave evolution a hard time. The laws of science support creation. The laws of science, not speculative science, but the laws of science, do help us to understand creation as it is from the hand of God. Tonight, my talk is really creation and evolution. What do the fossils tell us? Because the general impression that you're sold from school days and upwards is that the rocks are full of evidence for evolution. Well, let's look at that. That's our subject for tonight. First of all, I need to give you a very mini exposure to geology and tell you that you probably know this anyway, but let's just run over it. There are two main types of rocks. One are called igneous rocks. They were once molten, as they still are, 50 miles deep down beneath the Earth's crust, and they contain no fossils. And even I know that Aberdeen and most of the northeast is built on granite, so you have a hard job to find fossils up here. However, in the Kingdom of Kent, to which I belong, there are some igneous rocks, but there are many more sedimentary rocks. As the name suggests, these rocks were laid down as sediment by a flood or floods, and they were laid down in layers, and it's in those rocks that fossils are found. Examples being sandstone, limestone, coal seams, shale seams, which are abundant in central Scotland. Now, just to show you one of the nice pictures, here's a picture from the East Duke of Fife, which is a set of basalt columns. I don't think there are those in the northeast, at least I haven't found them yet. But there, to give you some sense of scale, is a picture of my grandson when he was 10 years younger against a cliff made of igneous rock, basalt columns. And there are many examples of that on the west coast of Scotland as well. Here is an example of sedimentary rock. And you can see already that sedimentary rock is made up of layers. The official name is strata. And within these layers, there are fossils often to be found. These are sandstone layers. The dark bands there and there are actually coal seams, quite thin ones, but they exist all around the coast of Fife. And in these sedimentary rocks is where we find fossils. Here's a good example. Once more, I'm showing you a picture of Liberty Hill, my almost eldest granddaughter, taken some many years ago, almost 20 years ago to be precise, taken on a layer of sedimentary rock which is normally submerged by the sea. So at low tide, you can go down there and find a beautiful fossil. There it is, a fossilized tree trunk. And for a better picture of it, I'll here with it, the little girl of it, there it stands. Quite a large fossil. It is approximately a yard long by 18 inches across. And you can see then from that picture how the fossil has preserved the texture of the back of that tree trunk. And that's a good example of what a fossil is, and they are to be found in many places throughout the world. However, a big question arises, how can you actually become a fossil? It's very, very difficult, may I say. So don't worry, even though some people call us oldies fossils, we're not really. It's very, very difficult to become a fossil. The normal process when a creature dies is either that one or that one. In other words, here's me imagining a fish swimming in the sea, and for some reason it expires. And if it settles down on the seabed, eventually it gets buried, and very slowly as the layers of sediment on the seabed build up. And by the time it gets buried, there's nothing left of it but a few bones. Not fossilized bones, just ordinary bones. The other option is that the fish dies and is swimming about either on the surface or near the surface. And when it expires, there are other little fishes who are hungry. No longer trying to eat it up, and there's not much of it left, so you don't get fossils that way. The normal process of death and burial or scavenging leaves no fossil residue. To be a fossil, something like this is to happen. A fish is suddenly swimming along one day, and suddenly it is engulfed by a huge mass of sediment, which sweeps over it and buries it quickly. And as the sediment buries it, more sediment builds up on top until the pressure on top of it becomes so immense that it's squeezed and flattened. And processes of cementation and petrification take over and turn the skeleton, and sometimes a lot of its soft tissue, into rock fragments which bear the imprint of the original creature. So then in brief is how you become a fossil. Now, fossils do exist all over the world, under a whole variety of types. And some scientists have thought, well, let's look at this. And from about 200 years ago, people have been looking into the columns of geology and examining the fossils that they contain. And they built up what's called the geological column, which many of you will have seen in school textbooks. You can't read the small writing, I don't expect you to, but up this column here are various strange sounding names which are given to the classes of sediment and the fossils they contain. One I want you to remember is this one near the bottom between the purple and the mauve band. This is called the Cambrian level, which I'll be speaking about shortly, and it is estimated, not the word, estimated, but that is about 5,000 million years old. Whether or not that's the case, we'll investigate later. But I'm simply putting this column up to remind you that it's taken for granted that this is something we should notice and believe in. However, keeping going from there, given that there is a column with fossils in it at different levels, the headline claims by people like the BBC, by people who indulge in giving you documentaries on nature and natural events, will be telling you that this fossil record in the geological column becomes more complete all the time, and it shows a clear sequence of change. I'm sure you've heard this or read it somewhere before. But actually, here's another quote. Geology assuredly does not reveal any such finely graduated organic chain. And this, perhaps, says the writer, is the most obvious and gravest objection which can be used against my theory. Who do you think said that? No less a person than Charles Darwin, back in 1859. Have things improved since that? Well, let's listen to one or two other comments. Here's 1979. A quote from the senior paleontologist in the British Museum in London writes, he'd written a book on evolution. transition. And somebody asked him, why have you not illustrated it with these transition forms that you tell us exist? And he says, I have to agree that there's a lack of these illustrations in my book. If I knew of any, a fossil or a living creature, I would certainly have included them. I will lay it on the line. There is not one such fossil of which one could make a watertight argument. Now that's something to think about. It's not quite what the headline news tells you. The missing links, which evolution requires and demands, the missing links are not there. In spite of those headline claims, in spite of the popular perception, let's look at some other quotes. In the Origin of Species, Darwin showed that the record was useless for testing evolution against special creation because it has great gaps in it. That was roughly the first quote I showed you. Says this speaker, the same argument still applies. The great gaps are still there. In any case, says this speaker, no real evolutionist uses the fossil record as evidence in favor of the theory of evolution as opposed to special creation. That was a quote by a scientist called Mark Ridley, belonging to Oxford University, in 1981. And Mark Ridley, you may be interested to know, is a colleague of a certain Richard Dawkins, who holds firmly to the theory of evolution and propounds it with great vigour. What I wanted to show you is that what you hear on popular media, what you read about in textbooks saying that the evolution theory depends on the fossil record and is borne out by the fossil record, is not actually true. And even a dyed-in-the-wool evolutionist like this, Mark Ridley, is telling us that, well, it's not there, so we're not looking for it anymore. You see, for hundreds of years since Darwin, there was vigorous, really vigorous search for these missing links. But they proved to be as missing as ever. And you know why? They weren't there in the first place. So evolution theory is not supported by the fossil record. Let's proceed for one or two examples, and first of all, tackle this big question. How old are these rocks anyway? Here's roughly the argument by which people have built up the geological column and come to some conclusions about its age. I read this personally in a museum some years ago, and it says, because plants and animals evolve over time, we could use fossils to estimate the age of the rocks. So they have already assumed that evolution is true. They've made the assumption that plants and animals evolve over time, and in their view, that is over millions of years. So if that is true, they can use fossils in different parts of the geological column to estimate the age of the rocks. That is honestly how it's done. But anyway, how do you know about the age of the rocks? How do you know about the age of the fossils now? Well, you then read that the age of a fossil is given by reference to the rock in which it is found. Now, can you see the dilemma? The one thing supports the other. You're arguing around in a circle. The age of the fossil comes from the rock. The age of a rock comes from the fossil. There is no independent check. So these figures, like, what did we say? 5,000 million years, which is estimated to be the age of that point in the geological column I mentioned, that's really up for grabs. Unless you find some independent way of checking it. Well, needless to say, there are independent ways of checking it, so let's look at these and see if it is true, if it has been confirmed that the Earth, for example, is 5,000 million years old. Not even older. How is that measured? It's measured by going into these igneous rocks that I mentioned, chunks of granite and the like, the oldest rocks that geologists speak about, and you measure certain aspects of radioactivity that's found in some of these rocks. Everybody here knows that the element uranium is a radioactive one, and over time it changes from uranium into lead at a certain rate, called its half-life. Now I've used figures which are deliberately simplified. These figures are not the actual figures, I've simply used them for illustration. So for example, if we find that in a ton of this rock, there will be 1 gram per million years accumulating by the decay of uranium to lead, that's one thing we can measure. The half-life can be measured. So the next thing we measure is, well, how much lead is there actually in the sample? And let's say that the sample now is shown to contain 25 grams of lead per ton. So can we do the sums and calculate the age? Yes, of course you can. If it's 1 gram per million years in a ton, and you have 25 grams, it means it's taking 25 million years for that lead to accumulate. Yeah? A bit of logic there. But, as in almost every scientific calculation, there are built-in assumptions. Last evening, I took some pains to point out the hazards of extrapolation, how things are not always uniform over huge spans of variables. It's the same here. And this calculation, or the real calculation with the real figures, is only true if, number one, the rate hasn't changed. The rate might not have changed in our lifetime. The rate might not have changed over 100 years, which is roughly as long as accurate measurements have been made of radioactive half-life. The rate might not have changed over 1,000 years. It might not have changed over 1,000 years, although you seem to extrapolate further and further, but can we be absolutely sure that this rate of decay of uranium into lead has not changed over that period of time? 25 million years, which we can hardly even envisage. I mean, can you think what 25 million years is like? But there's another thing, another if. This calculation is only correct, will only give the correct answer if there was no lead in the sample at the beginning. And that's a bigger if. Because if we're thinking on the, however you want this, think about it, if we're thinking of when the original igneous rock was formed and uranium was in it, which is a relatively unstable element, it is more probable that along with the unstable uranium, you would have stable lead there to begin with. So the fact that there is an assumption that no lead was in the sample to begin with renders this figure rather suspect, means it could be a lot shorter, a lot smaller than it actually is. Fossils in the rock are used to date the rock if evolution theory is true. If the evolution theory can't have long periods of time, like millions and millions of years, it won't work. It says it needs all this time to get going, to get developed. And the way to check it is using this radioactivity measurement. But that radioactivity measurement and the answer it gives is only valid if these two things are true. And both of them might not be true. And in my view, the second one is very unlikely to be true. So just take these figures of millions and millions of years with a large pinch of salt. Well, back to our geological column. There is this area I have to keep your eye on, which they say by these calculations was 5,000 million years ago. And coming up the column, about the middle of it is 58 million years ago, when they tell us that animals like lizards and dinosaurs and their friends appeared on the Earth. And more recently, just 10 million years ago, the ones at the top of the column, which are these kind of things up there, and even caveman, began to emerge. And all of this is built on these measurements and calculations of the age of the Earth, which people quote to you without blinking. If you go to any museum, or if you listen to anybody talking about this, they will mention these figures as if they were absolutely certain. Let me assure you, friends, they are not absolutely certain. They are suspect. They are probably wrong. But people believe in them. because they want to believe in evolution. Because these figures are only valid only if certain conditions are fulfilled, only if evolution is all there is, only if these calculations and the assumptions in them can be relied upon. And I put in my neck out in suggesting to you, indeed stating to you, that there is good reason to believe that these conditions are not valid at all. Right then, let's have another look at the fossil evidence. And the particular point I want you to look at is that dotted line across the middle of the screen, where we have a boundary between what is called the Cambrian layer or rocks and the pre-Cambrian layer. That's the one that took place, we say, 5,000 million years ago. Why is it important? It's important because, well, let's look at this line. Before the Cambrian layer of fossils, Darwin made a model, which is called the Tree of Life, and says that all the different life forms along the bottom axis, it reads morphology or species, and all the different species presented by these branches of the tree, as he called them, they evolve gradually from simpler forms by branching out at various places. And at each of the joints in this tree, there were life forms that are no longer around, but if they were around, they should be in the fossil record, but sorry, we can't find them. And during pre-Cambrian times, the only evidence we have is Darwin's model. Let's look next at the actual data. What is recorded in the higher layers of the geological column after the Cambrian level? And we find these actual data are like this. Each of these blobs represent life forms. For example, this might represent a reptile, which became extinct about there. This other one, for example, might represent a horse, which has ancestors down there and continues up to the present. And this one might be a cow, this one might be the dodo, and so on. So, different species along the bottom, which there is evidence for in the actual geological layer, but below the Cambrian level, there is no evidence for it. There is no pre-Cambrian fossils. And what we find in this geological column is the sudden appearance of complex creatures already there in set bands of species, which I'm going to call different kinds for a reason that will come apparent. So what the fossil evidence is telling you is there's hardly anything before 5,000 million years ago. But somehow or other, from there on, there were life forms, some of which have become extinct, like this wee fellow here. Others which have continued through the time period that's still with us. And in the fossil record, there are evidences of those. So evolution theory is up against a problem. Let's look at the problem. The earliest fossils, the ones that suddenly appear at this Cambrian level, are already very complex creatures. They're not simple blobs. They're well-developed, complex creatures. No simpler ones exist. The geologists and the paleontologists say there is this thing called the Cambrian explosion, when it appears that as if there was an explosion of life forms all suddenly coming to pass at the same time. And for evolution, that poses a problem. That's not how it's meant to happen. Secondly, and I've touched on this already, the missing links are still missing. No hybrid life forms have been found in the fossil record. All the fossil records that you can find are recognizable types of creatures. They're not identical to present day ones, but they are recognizable. And more than that, the column that I showed you is a theoretical one. Nowhere on the face of the Earth will you find the complete geological column from bottom to top. You'll find chunks of it here and chunks of it there. Different shallow overlap here and there. And putting all these bits together Theoreticians have built the geological column, but it's not all in one place. Nor is it complete. There are parts missing. And many of these strata, which the evolutionists tell us should be in a certain order, sometimes are inverted. Sometimes what they call younger rocks are beneath older ones. And you get fossils in the wrong place, at least they're in the wrong place according to theory, and they're in the right place according to the actual investigation and the data, but they're in the wrong place according to theory. What do you make of that? Here's a good example. That's a slab of sandstone on which you can see, if you actually look at the real one, the imprint of some creature, which actually is no longer with us. His name, or maybe it's our name, we must be careful these names and what term to use, its name is Apioptera. And from the skeleton impressed on the stone, artists have drawn what they think is a picture of Mr. or Mrs. Apioptera. If you looked at that, what would you say it was? I think it's pretty like a bird to me. Not a bird that's around these days, but it's certainly pretty much like a bird. It might have one or two features that are not seen in birds nowadays, but for all the world, that's a bird to me. However, the big problem is, if you assume it's a halfway stage between a reptile and a bird, the problem is that it was found in a layer which makes it older than its supposed ancestor. You see, the theory says all these kind of things came from reptiles, came from dinosaur types, eventually became birds, in that order. But here's a poor fellow that got it wrong. He's older than his supposed parents. Well, like that works, doesn't it? This long time business. Evolution says it's roughly the millions of years, because by the time these lower life forms build up new features, it's going to take a long, long time for the successive generation. But if you think about it, long ages of time are not a good idea for the evolution theory. You actually present a problem or two. A problem like this: over long periods of time, everything moves towards an equilibrium stability. This is like what I showed you last evening with the castle that was once big and beautiful and has tumbled down over a few hundred years. If you think about any chemical system, any natural system, it will always move from a less stable state to a more stable state at a certain equilibrium. Things become less complex, become more simple over time. But then evolution theory says, no, things started off simple and small, and became more complicated, and became more developed over time. That's not the case. Over time, things go the wrong way for evolution theory. They go more simple. Another problem is that over time, instead of getting new species appearing, what we actually find is that many species become extinct. I mentioned the dodo. I mentioned the dinosaurs. There are evidence of those, either in records that are hundreds of years old in the case of dodos, or in the case of the fossil record in the case of dinosaurs. They disappear. And nobody, I mean no naturalist anywhere, has yet discovered a new species. That's fanciful. Loss of variety is what we see, not increase in new variety, unless, as I said last evening, it is within a given species by developing the features of that species. So while evolution argues heavily in favour of long periods of time, it is not really in its best interests, based on the wider laws of science, as I tried to tell you about last evening. The other thing that I mentioned yesterday, if you were here, you'll recall this, as time goes on, the energy required by any living system becomes less useful. Entropy wastes the energy that's available. And the longer this unit actually exists, the more its entropy will increase, and the less useful will be the energy that belongs to it. And there's another thing I haven't mentioned as yet. There seems to be very sound evidence that in the Earth's fairly recent past, there have been ice ages. The Earth almost entirely at times has been blanketed by ice. How do living forms cope with ice ages? They interrupt the flow of life forms. They destroy life forms, often irreversibly. And these things are all asking us to think about, is it actually true that evolution took all that time? Is it actually true that evolution needs all that time? Is it actually true that evolution is true? What I'm trying to tell you tonight is that there is a huge amount of evidence that says evolution is not the way it happened. Let's keep going. The fact is that we do have evidence for fossils. How did they get there? Evolution says they got there by a process of perhaps many floods, multiple floods, developing creatures in salt and sediment and burying them in successive layers over millions of years. There's another way, at least one other way, of thinking about fossils. And believe it or not, we find some evidence of it in this old book that many of us love and read, called the Bible. And even from childhood days, I'm sure everyone has heard about Noah and the flood. And everyone will have seen caricature pictures of the ark with animals sticking out windows and so on. Please remember that is a caricature, that is not a Bible story. So let's take a few minutes just as this lecture moves on. I promise not to go over the time. Let's take a few minutes to go back to the biblical story of Genesis and a really big flood. It was an immense flood. Now, some of you, probably all of you, have looked at pictures on TV over the recent years of flooding which has taken place in many parts of the world. And even localized flooding over several thousand square miles causes terrible devastation, doesn't it? But this flood is bigger than any you've ever seen. And floods create erosion of the landscape. Floods destroy life forms wholesale, both vegetation and animal. And if this flood, as the Bible says, was really an immense one, you would expect huge amounts of erosion of the landscape and destruction of everything in its wake. Anything that's caught in the flood water, that's caught in the erosed sediment, any creatures would be rapidly buried in flood-borne silt, like that little fish that I showed you a few minutes ago. And then, having been buried beneath one layer of silt, the chemistry processes that are at work in the flood water would cement them all together and turn them to stone. And so you certainly would get fossils made quickly by a huge flood. Looking at the order in which we may now expect to see these creatures, it would make sense if you thought about a scenario of creatures entering into the landscape being threatened by a flood. The ones in the sea, the ones in the water, couldn't do much about it. They can't get out of the water, they'd be very fast. So the lowest sediments would contain the, shall I just call them, the fishy creatures. Those that are halfway between the sea and the land, those amphibians, might try to wriggle a bit further and get out of the way, but they would follow. And then the more mobile creatures, the dinosaurs maybe, but they're not too good at running fast, followed by the antelopes and the deer and such like, followed by, well, you name them, you know how fast you can run, they would escape the effects of the flood for the longest. And so these layers that are built up one on top of the other are not historical zones, They are what we call ecological zones. So the ecology of the bottom layer is the ecology of the water layer. The ecology of the next layer is the ecology of the margin between water and dry land. And then you work them up until you find that all of the features that existed on the Earth's surface are swallowed up and buried and fossilized in the order in which they appeared ecologically, but all at more or less the same time. Does that work? Well, let's examine it a bit more. Here's a mostly good, they're not very clever, but an attempt at showing what might happen during the course of a flood. The bluish bit on the left hand side is meant to represent the sea or at least waterborne creatures. And then you can see this one, which is called a trilobite. And along here, you can see a reptile just getting out of the water. On the dry land, the green bit in the top and right hand side gives us the vegetation of the trees, dragonflies, other insects, various types of dinosaurs which are trying hard to get away, until we come to the more mobile ones, including these ones at the top and maybe even mankind himself. And as the flood waters increase, and as the amount of sediment increases, they're going to be buried in layers roughly corresponding to where they existed when the flood and the sediment overtook them. So my point tonight really is that fossils can be better explained by rapid burial in flood-borne silt. Everybody agrees on that point. Followed by what would happen in an immense flood is not just a tranquil sea on a calm morning. An immense flood is accompanied by violent movement caused by the earth rotation and caused by imbalance of the flood. So you get what's called hydrological shocking. You know what that is if your ladies are making a sweep? You're mixing stuff up anyway, and you know the heavier stuff eventually goes to the bottom. That's hydrological sorting. So fossils would be sorted out according to their density by the stirring action of the water, by the stirring on the surface. So it's not surprising that some fossils won't be mixed with others outside the ecological zone, although the main picture will be these ecological zones. Other things that have worked on the Earth's surface. The Bible itself in Genesis hints that during the flood there were huge volcanic activities taking place. And these would change the layers of rocks from a straightforward flat region to one that's bent and twisted and tilted, which is exactly what we see on the seashore. In some parts of our shore, the layers of sandstone, sediment or rock are almost dead flat. In others, they've tilted through 90 degrees or more because there's been pushing up from underneath from these igneous rocks that are still molten. They'll break through the surface, creating volcanoes, most of which are in that part of the world and are extinct. But you can see evidence of them all over the place. Then, I'm saying to you that fossils are explainable best by strata, which are zones of habitat or zones of mobility, not a chronological record. And fossils are caused by a lot of water, not a lot of time. You don't need these thousands of millions of years to make fossils. All you need is a huge amount of water, which the idea I believe in makes more sense of the fossil record than the smooth evolutionary aspect that is so often presented to you. Here's a couple of pictures which you're looking at. This top one might represent these layers of sediment as laid down by the flood. There is the level of the sea, a fairly shallow sea at the moment. And there are two or three levels of strata. in which you will find fossils laid into these strata according to where they were found when the floodwater broke. However, earth movements, volcanic activity, result in the faulting of these strata so that you get breaks in them. Here, for example, is an upward push, which may be caused by a volcano underneath it, or may certainly be caused by a balancing act. When the water goes to one side, the rocks will go to the other, the usual balance again. So what will happen next is that through the sea level, there will break higher mountains, and beneath the sea level, there will occur deeper trenches, which is exactly what we find nowadays. I know by standards the North Sea isn't anything like the deepest sea, but you go west of Shetland and you find the water is really deep, as some of you oil men will know. And if you go to the Pacific, you will find there's the deepest trench in the world, which is miles and miles deep. Similarly, if you go to Benahee, well, okay, it's a nice mountain, not a nice hill, but if you go to Everest, that's another story. And don't think that Everest was always 29,000 feet in altitude. Before the flood, Everest was really quite a small hill. It got a good push, I think, after the flood, and both the Himalayan mountain chains and the Swiss Alps and the Sierras of South America and all the huge mountain chains on the world were probably formed by the upheavals that took place in the Earth's crust after the flood. So there were huge changes at the flood. Changes in what we would call topography, just what I've talked about. The hills became higher, the valleys became deeper, the sea level went deeper. So it's worth thinking that the world we live in now is quite different from what the world looked like before the flood. Huge changes took place and have persisted ever since. Also, tectonics came into play. You've heard of continental drift. You've heard of how tsunamis and earthquakes occur by the plates and the Earth's surface grinding against each other until they can no longer contain the energy and it bursts out. And these tectonics may well have begun after the flood, because the separation of these plates and their drift and the volcanic activity around the edges probably took place as a result of the flood. The atmosphere changed, I think, I'm pretty sure. Before the flood, the Bible tells us that there was a water canopy, a vapor canopy, surrounding the earth. But after the flood came, that water canopy disappeared. Almost all of it precipitated onto the earth that caused the flood. By the way, the flood was caused by two things: rain coming down from above and water rising up from beneath. If you think about the effect of the water canopy, people nowadays are worried about the greenhouse effect, the accumulation of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, which is leading to global warming. Which, yes, does have its risks, nor present day mankind. But actually, some of you will use greenhouses in Aberdeen to try and make things grow better. So that before the flood, there was a naturally imposed greenhouse effect, not by carbon dioxide, but by water vapor, which led to several things that the Bible even tells you about, like people living a lot longer. One of the reasons for us not living as long as we might like to is that aging is promoted by being bombarded with radiation from outer space. But this layer of water vapor protects us on Earth from outer space radiation. And plants and things would grow a lot better, and animals would thrive a lot better in that kind of condition. So that both the vegetation on the Earth's surface and the range of animals and plants on the Earth's surface would not only be a greater range, but would grow to a greater extent. And that's maybe why we are dinosaurs, that's maybe why we choose trees. which are now evidence in the fossil record. And they could continue after the flood, extinction would become the norm, because they either had to adapt or perish. Those that were able to adapt continued, and we have most of them around today. Those that couldn't adapt, such as the dinosaurs, perish, and are only found in the fossil record. And one more thing. On the Earth at the moment, we're approaching somewhere around 7 or 8 billion people. I couldn't do the sums, but somebody has done the sums that from you get from 3 couples to about 6 billion people, at an average of 2 or 3 children per family in stable times, takes something of the order of 5,000 years. The story of the Bible is that Noah had 3 sons. And from the 3 couples in Noah's family, the Bible says the whole earth was populated. And modern genetic studies reveal that out, not only in terms of the 3 main families of mankind, 3 distinct branches of the human race, but in rough terms, corresponding the earth's present population, if you allow about, and I use the word about all in this context, about 5,000 years. So this immense, immense life took place thousands of years ago, not millions of years ago. The fossils are dated from thousands of years ago, not millions of years ago. And there is no fact of science that denies that. Science cannot categorically prove that any fossil is millions of years old. It is assumed that they are, and it is assumed that they are because it is built on an evolutionary model, which, as I showed you yesterday, is theoretical, is suppositional, is not supported by the laws of science, and many other things. So my big question was, created or evolved? What does science say? Tried to deal with that last evening. What do the rocks tell us? The rocks tell us that evolution wasn't really the best explanation. There's a much better one, if you believe what the Bible says. Let's conclude this by thinking about the flood in another context. The Bible does tell us that the flood was a violent episode. Water came down from above, came up from beneath. The Bible does tell us that there were 40 days of rain. And the flood itself lasted for a whole year. Now, if we get 4 days of rain, we're really probably parts of the UK were inundated last year with several days of rain. And floods did come, which caused havoc, but they were only a matter of a week or two. This is a different league. 40 days of non-stop rain coming down, coupled with fountains bubbling up from underneath and spreading and creating havoc. This is what the Bible tells us. And the Bible also says it was one of life. It wasn't just a localized flood in the land of the Middle East. It was worldwide. And actually, fossils are found worldwide, which to me is evidence that the flood was worldwide. I mean, I know the Bible says that, and I believe it because the Bible says it. But the fact that you get fossils all over the world, all over the world, if my thesis is right, if this idea I'm showing you is right, shows that the flood was certainly not a localized mini episode that we could deal with and look up in a few days. It was vast. One more thing though, in the Bible, the cause of this big flood is explained. Some people try to explain present day floods. It's usually carried up into the realms of meteorology, talk about the jet stream, talk about the El Nino effect, localized things that happen in the Earth's atmosphere. I think that's very interesting. What was the cause of this great flood that we read about in the Bible? Well, the Bible itself tells us. Let's look at it briefly. It actually tells us that God judges sin. The fossils that we find all over the world are not just telling us about creatures that once existed and creatures that are ancestors of the ones that we have now. The Bible record is that this great flood has a meaning and a message for everybody who thinks about it. It is that God judges sin. Because God sent the flood. God sent the flood as a punishment and a judgment upon a civilization that had got so bad that you couldn't do other than bring a deserved punishment to it. However, God isn't arbitrary. God never sends judgment without providing an opportunity for folk to avoid it. And so he told Noah, I don't know if that's the realistic picture or not, but look, this is a scale picture. That's the size of Noah and his family. Compared to the size of the ark, there's no mini ship to go out from Aberdeen Harbour. And God provided salvation from the coming judgment to everyone who would accept it. He provided a flood-proof ark. He did warn that judgment was coming. God said, judgment is coming. Change your ways. It's coming soon. Not coming tomorrow. He actually gave them 120 years warning. He said, don't stay where you are. Do come on board. Just let your own. Noah made that message very, very clear. He said, if you come on board, you'll be guaranteed safety. And I promise you that things will be better in the future. And the people listened to Noah. You know what they did? Ha 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 ha. We've never seen rain yet in this world. Why are you holding a boat in the middle of the landscape anyway? They said, no chance. No chance. We're not coming. We don't believe it. But of course, it happened. Well, nowadays, we're not looking for a big flood. But we do know that this world in which we live is getting worse. We do know that people's sin in God's sight, even in our sight, is getting worse. Those who bring the idea of morals and righteousness and justice are often appalled at things that are happening in society. Not just society in the Middle East with these folk who go around blowing folk up, but happening in St. Lawrence, happening in Aberdeen. Things that you never thought you would see in your lifetime are happening. And not only do we see it, but God sees it, and God says, one of these days, it's going to change. But I'm providing for you a judgment proof salvation. You say, do I need that? Or do you know best whether you need it or not? Do you know best if you can escape from God's judgment on your life? If you think you're perfect, then fine. But I've never actually met anyone who's perfect. And God says if you're going to be accepted by me and get into heaven, you need perfection such as only I can get. So just think about that. Do you need a judgment-proof salvation? And if you need it, you say, well, good, but is it available? Can I have it? Has God made it available for everyone? And yes, he has. Available for everyone. Everyone in Aberdeen, everyone in Scotland, everyone from the whole wide world can have this judgment proof salvation. You say, if I accept it, does it guarantee that I'll be safe in my lifetime? No. Does it guarantee that I'll be safe forever? God says yes. You won't force you on board in the same way as Noah didn't force folk to come into the ark. They were invited, the door was wide open, and came in even the door was shut, it's too late. And God today by the gospel is inviting people to turn away from a life of sin, to accept his offer of free salvation. It is available for everyone. It does guarantee eternal salvation. But it's up to you to choose it, accept it. Let me leave you tonight with three things that the Lord Jesus Christ said. He invites you, he says, come to me, and I will give you rest. He guarantees to receive you. Whoever comes to me, he says, whoever comes to me, no matter whether you think you're too good or too bad or too anything, whoever comes to me, I'll never throw away. And he says, if you come,
You'll get eternal life, and you'll never perish. It is yours indeed forever. It is judgment proof. It is available. But the big thing is, have you accepted it? Thanks for listening. Let's once more give thanks for the cup of tea, and thanks again for listening. I hope you'll come again tomorrow. Our Father, we give thanks for thy goodness to us all today. In many ways we've known your blessings and your care. And we come now and ask that you will bless each one of us present here. We ask that you will draw near to each one. And if anyone here is not sure about the great matter of salvation and freedom from judgment to come, may they find it by trusting in the Lord Jesus. We give thanks then for bringing these things to us. Help us to understand them, maybe be challenged by them. And we give thanks for this cup of tea we're going to share and the opportunity of talking to each other. We give thanks for all these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ.